Well, good evening. What a crowd. You certainly look wonderful out there. You can all be up here and take a look at you out there. Well, I'm Clarence Snyder. I'm not Clarence S., I'm Clarence Snyder. I used to take a lot of funny names before I ever came here. I'm very proud of my name now, and everyone, I like everyone to know it. And I live in Castleberry, Florida. And I'm certainly tickled to death to be here. I've always wanted to visit Hawaii. And I never... I don't. And finally, I was invited. And I do want to thank the committee who invited me, and people such as you and Buzz, Francis, Ben, and others. I can't name them all. But hasn't this been something great? Wasn't that some show last night? That's the best show I've ever seen. I've been out to Las Vegas and seen shows, and it's not anything like that one. This was a real humdinger. I wanted to come out and see a hula dancer, and I waited till last night. I've been here 3 days before I saw one. I sort of got my fill last night. I'm also happy to find some old friends sitting around here. I can't name them all, but I do want to name especially a pair that came from Florida to give me some support. Tom and Jenny Daly are here from Jupiter, Florida, and they're old friends of mine, and they come down here quite often to Hawaii. Then I couldn't help but run into this fellow down here, Clancy. He's everywhere. But I knew him back in Ohio. And then there's Mark Barry here from Idaho. Lots more. Can't name them all. I got to get on with this talk because I understand I'm not supposed to talk as long as I usually do. I got shut off once today at a meeting. So I guess they have schedules here. I remember one time I was speaking at an international up somewhere in Canada, I think it's Toronto, and they had a series of buttons on here, lights. It got green light, you're all right. It gets yellow, look out. And when it turns red, bing, you stop. That's the end of it. If you're in the middle of a sentence. Well, you know, I never learned my AA that way. I used to hang around saloons until the person who swept me out with the cigar butts in the morning. We used to turn the clocks back in those joints. But all of a sudden, people come to AA and they got to get home right away. They go to meetings and, boy, after an hour, let's get out of here. You know, some of the greatest things ever happened to me in meetings were after the meetings. That's where I got some real advice and fellowship after meetings. Some of the greatest things that happened to me. Well, so much for that. How did I get here in the first place? I'm a freak. I really am in AA because I came to a fellowship which did not yet exist. Now, you have to be a rummy to do something like that. There was no AA when I arrived here. I came into the Oxford group. And by a series of miracles, all miracles, I arrived here. I'd been on the bum. And back and forth, I was married to a gal who was a member of a very clannish family. And this family was always in my home. There were always one, two, three, or four of them in my house at any one time. And this family used to have family conferences. But I was never invited to the conferences for the simple reason I was usually the subject under discussion. The discussions ran along the line as to whether they're going to let me back in my own house again or throw me out again. Well, this all came to a head one day. They had a conference, and I was between jobs for several years at that time. And they had a solution for this. My wife had a brother who owned one of these big tractor-trailer outfits, and he hauled merchandise between New York City and Cleveland. And they decided that I should be his helper. I should learn to drive this outfit, and he could ride herd on me and see that I didn't drink. And at the same time, I'd be useful, which would be quite a change. So I had to go along with this deal or be thrown out again, so I went along. It scared me to death for several reasons. The idea of driving a truck suggested hard work to me, and I've always been against hard work. And I never did recover from that yet. But we started off for New York one night, and boy, we drove all night. I remember that. I thought, wasn't this guy ever going to stop? In the morning, he stopped for breakfast over in New York State. We went on from there that night. We got to Albany, New York, and he conked out. He had a rest. He had a sleeping cab there. I was asleep up in the nest behind a little window up there, and he would sleep on a seat when his sleep was to be done. So he finally had a rest. So he said he's going to pull over the curb, and he's going to rest for a few hours. I said, fine. I had a dollar and some cents in change secreted around my person that he didn't know about. So I had a little capital to start with. So I pulled over there and I'm out of there. I said, this is Albany, this is the capital of New York. I always want to see the Capitol buildings. And away I went. It's funny things as you remember. I ran into the first watering hole I saw and I ran right out again because it was too rich for my blood. And so I went down the street a few blocks and I got into a place that was more suitable to a man of my estate. A dump, a joint. I had enough to start with and I met an angel there. I think he was a fairy, but I'll call him an angel. Because he starts buying me drinks and boy, I was throwing them in as fast as they came. The thing started getting kind of sticky and I thought I'd better make my exit. I went to the men's room, locked the door, and went out the window. As far as I know, he's still waiting for me. So I hobbled back to this truck, and by the time I got back then, I was an everyday drinker. I was not a periodic, so I hadn't drank for a couple of days, and I was really in shape. And I think all those drinks must have hit me at once as I started back for the truck, because getting back into the truck, I stepped on that poor boy's face. And of course, church was out. And but he carried me on into New York City and he threw me out on the waterfront and told me that's the end, don't ever come back to Cleveland, you're dead, you're done here, don't ever come back, it's your last go-round. Well, I didn't have any money by then, but I knew only one family in greater New York. There was another sister of his, and she lived in Yonkers, and she owed me something, and I'm sure she did. If I told you the whole story, you'd agree. So I figured certainly Virginia will give me some place to roost and help me out. I made it out to Yonkers, and I remember she used to live way up on a hill. But I didn't go up on that hill. I was there when on my honeymoon. I say we always did everything together. That family, they instituted togetherness. So instead of going up the hill, I went down the hill and got in the Italian section down there. And in those days, those were bootleg days, all Italians had wine. They all drank it. A lot of them made it. Some of them sold it. Some of them shared it with their friends. So I went down there and made friends. By the time I got up to her home, I was a sight for sore eyes. I can only remember a couple of things of that trip to her home. I was rolling around on the floor with her two little babies, little girls, 2 or 3 years old. And I'm dirty, and I'm drunk, and I'm odoriferous. And Virginia took a dim view of this, and she put me in the back of her car and took me downtown where her brother had thrown me out, and she did likewise. I tell you this story for a reason. It's one of the miracles. Sometime later, Virginia had a doctor out to her house. That's when doctors used to make house calls, and I think he was a friend of the family anyway. They got to talking about drinking, and she related the story of my trip and my visit there. And she told him what a nice guy I used to be, her favorite brother-in-law, and what a no-good drunken bum I am now. He says, you know, that's odd. He says, I have a brother-in-law who was a lush, and he met some strange cult of people here in New York. And since he met this cult, he don't drink anymore. And he runs around New York trying to fix drunks. And he brings them home, they smash up his furniture and mess up his house. But he don't have much luck with them, but he's trying. But he says there's a doctor in Akron, Ohio, Dr. Robert Smith, who also belongs to this strange cult. And he spends all of his time fixing drunks. He says, now if your brother-in-law ever gets back to Cleveland, maybe he can be directed to Akron and meet this doctor, and this doctor can fix him. Of course, I don't know this is going on. They're always doing things behind my back. But eventually, after some months in New York on the bum and existing there, which I did, I could tell you, write a book about that experience. Some of the funny things, I don't have time to tell them, and I want to do it tonight, because some of them are scream. But anyway, I got back. Eventually, one trucker took me to Erie, and another one took me into the outskirts of Cleveland, where I lived. And I went to try to get in the house, but Dorothy wouldn't let me in. But this doctor, who told Virginia about his brother-in-law, happened to be Bill Wilson's brother-in-law, Dr. Leonard Strong. And the doctor he's talking about in Akron, Ohio, is Dr. Bob Smith. Now, here I am up there, a stranger, and this is before any AA, before anything, and I'm indirectly getting in touch with the two guys who are accredited with starting this whole ball of wax. What do you call that? I call that a miracle. There's nothing else. Well, and Dorothy wouldn't let me in the house. That's another long story. She wouldn't even unhook the screen door, and the screens are up in the middle of winter. But she told me about this doctor in Akron and asked me if I'd like to go down and meet him. And I had nothing to lose. I could transact my business in Akron as well as I could in Cleveland. So she put me in the back of her car and drove me down to the bus depot. She gave me Dr. Smith's name and address, and she bought me a one-way ticket to Akron and goodbye. And that's how I met my sponsor. Eventually, he put me in Akron City Hospital, not for alcoholism, anything but. He wouldn't allow drunks in hospitals in those days. But that's where I sobered up. After I came out, when I was in that hospital, I got my first big shock and my big surprise. I was told that he had some way of fixing drunks, and he's a medical doctor. So I expected medical help. I expected some kind of an operation, really. And I got the shock of my life. The men who preceded me, there was about 12 or 14 of them in Akron, the alcoholics. They came in to visit me while I was in the hospital. None of them were sober very long. And they all told me the story of their lives, what had happened to them through booze. And everyone told me the same thing. When he concluded his story, he told me he had the answer to my drinking problem. And on that note, they left. And I lay there wondering what the answer is. Well, I know my doctor was a surgeon. He was a rectal surgeon. And I was wondering about this new approach. So the last day that I'm in the hospital, Doc comes in as usual, and frankly, I was always scared to death of this guy. Doc was a big, tall, lanky guy, 6'4" and thin, and he had fingers on him this long. I believe they were an asset. And he came in this afternoon as usual and sat on the foot of my bed, and he looked at me, and he says, well, young fellow, he called me young fellow. I don't think he knew any of these guys' names. He hung a name on everybody. But I was young fellow because I was the youngest one. I was only 35 years old then, and all these other men were 10, 15, 20 years older than I was. That's why I am the oldest living one today. I just outlived them, that's all. He looked at me and says, "Well, young fellow, what do you think of all this by now?" I says, "Well, Doc, I think this is wonderful. These fellas all coming to see me. They don't know me from a bale of hay. They tell me their life story, but I am puzzled about one thing." He says, "And what's that?" I says, "They all tell me they have the answer to my drinking problem, but on that note they leave, they don't tell me the answer. What are you going to do? What comes next? See, I'm waiting for this operation." So he threw me a curve. He says, "Well, we don't know about you, young fellow. You're pretty young. We haven't any luck with these young fellows. They're all screwballs." Well, I wasn't going to argue that point with him. I guess I finally convinced him that I meant business. He says, "All right, young fellow, I'll give you the answer to this thing." He says, "Get down out of that bed." I says, "For what?" He says, "Get on your knees." I says, he hauls me out of there. I says, "What's coming?" He says, "You're going to pray." I says, "Who's going to pray?" I says, "You're going to pray." I says, "I don't know anything about praying." He says, "I don't suppose you do. You get down there, I'll pray, and you can repeat after me. That'll do for this time." So he hauls me out of that nice warm nest on that cold concrete floor in that shorty nightgown of mine. And he uttered a prayer, and I followed it after him. I don't remember what the prayer was, but I know pretty generally what it was. But I do remember this. When he concluded his prayer, he shook hands with me. He says, "Young fellow, you're going to be all right." And that night he carried me to a meeting of the Oxford Group in Akron, Ohio. And I attended meetings there for 15 months. And I never missed any meetings, only two nights in the whole year when I couldn't get through on account of the snow. I would go down there on weekends to be with those people. The alcoholics in that group were in a minority. We were a minority group. I'm just hearing about minority groups later. We were the original ones. Most of the people in the Oxford movement were not alcoholics. They were civilians, earth people. But we had our own clique down there. And I learned a lot of things. I listened. I was scared to death, but I listened to these people, and I did everything they told me to do. Everything possibly that I could do that they told me, I did. All right. What's about this thing of alcohol? Eventually, I can't go into all the things. I've got to cut out a lot of stuff here that I have to do this because I don't have the time. But I wanted to tell you about a lot of other things that leading up to this. But suffice to say, I got fixed up down there in that hospital, and I have been fixed. My sobriety date is February 11th, 1938. Let's talk about alcoholism and alcoholics for a few minutes. That seems to be a very favorite subject of ours, very interesting. What is alcoholism? To me, alcoholism is probably the oldest malady that afflicts the human race. You can read about alcoholism in ancient history.
You can read about it in mythology. You can read about it in the Bible. You don't have to go any further in the Bible than the first book of the Bible, in Genesis, and you'll meet your first rummy, our friend Noah. He was one of us. Just figure this. Here's a fella. Noah was a God-fearing man, and God loved him, of course. And the world got itself in such a shape about the way it is now, everything going downhill, see? And God had tried everything, and these people would not obey, and he only saw one out. Might as well destroy the whole ball of wax and start all over again. But he wanted some seed to start with. So he went to his friend Noah. He says, "Noah, my boy," he says, "I want you to do something for me." He says, "Anything, Lord." He says, "I want you to build a great big boat." And he gave him his dimensions and everything. And he says, "I want you and your family to fill that boat with two of every living creature and your families, because I'm going to destroy the whole world by a flood. And I want you to start things all over again, along with the animals and birds that you carry. I'll do anything, Lord." He was a very obedient servant. So Royal Noah and his family got out there cutting boards and sawing trees and hammering and making a lot of racket, and they're building this big boat. Well, naturally, the neighbors come along. "What are you doing there, Noah?" "We're building a boat." "A boat? Out here in the middle of a desert?" "Sure." Well, they say, "Oh, poor old Noah, he's just off key. He's had too much, you know. He's a little bit flat here." So they laughed at him, playing with a short deck. So they went on their way, but sure enough, they got this boat finished, this old ark, and they filled it up as God had told them to do. And the rains came, and they came, and they came, and they came for 40 days and 40 nights, and that thing started to raise up, and it floated around for a few months. And finally, the water started to recede, and that old ark landed on Mount Ararat, and the water went down, dry land came up. What was the first thing our friend Noah did when this happened? He tore out of that ark and went out and planted a vineyard. He raised some grapes and made some wine and got drunk. That old boy had been planning that all the time. There's a lot of good stories about rummies in the Bible. That story of the Good Samaritan. Gee, there's a rummy story. Everybody in it's a rummy. Oh boy, oh boy. I can't take the time to go into that story or the one about the two boys, this prodigal son. There's another rummy story. But read them in the Bible. They're terrific stories. They apply to us. We put ourselves right in the shoes of those people. I just mention this to let you know and bring to your mind, rather, that or your attention, that alcoholism has been here a long, 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 long time. And not until just about 40 years ago has been a solution found for the alcoholic. All down through these centuries, an alcoholic only had two options. He could go crazy, or he could die, or both. A little over 40 years ago, the alcoholic got a third option. He can still go crazy, he can die, or he can get well. Isn't that great? You and I have this option. Ask yourself tonight when you have your prayers, why do you and I have this option, and all those millions of people who preceded us never had this chance? Something to think about. Something to be thankful about. So we are really blessed. Well, how about this alcoholism and alcoholics? People talk about alcoholism as being a habit. They say he's got the drink habit or she's got the drink habit. It's not a habit, kids. We're all creatures of habit. Habit saves an awful lot of wear and tear on the brains. But it's not a habit. There's not a habit we have that we cannot break with a little willpower, won't power, and substitution, a little misery. If a doctor came along, take, for instance, this habit of smoking, which so many people indulge themselves so generously in. If a doctor came along and told you you didn't quit smoking, you'd be dead in 30 days, there isn't a person sitting in this room that wouldn't quit in 3 days. You could do it. So it's not a habit. We all have habits, and some of them are good, some are bad. As I say, a lot of them say wear and tear on the brains. We go through the same habit patterns every day. People talk about it being a taste. They say, boy, she loves that booze, or he loves that booze. Must drink 2 or 3 quarts of it a day. Actually, that is a fallacy. Most alcoholics do not like the taste of booze. There is a few oddballs here and there that do, but most of us didn't. And for evidence of that, take my own experience. I was unable to buy palatable liquor. And the last several years that I drank, I bought my booze in a wallpaper store, and I paid 7 cents a pint for it. And if you think I drank that for its palatable qualities, try it sometime. You have to work yourself down to that stuff. You're a real graduate when you're getting into that. No, it's not a matter of taste. It's not a matter of habit. Drinking to an alcoholic is an obsession. And that's something entirely different. That's something that controls us. It controls our life. Our program is designed to put our life back into control. And perhaps in a control we've never had before, even before we started drinking. That's a great blessing. Now, what about the alkie? The alcoholic. You know, I never heard that word alcoholic till I was dry for several years. We were always rummies, tosspots, bums, tramps, jugheads, whiskey heads, stuff like that. And somebody started calling us alcoholics when that book was getting prepared, and they elevated us. That was a graduation. We were somebody. Now, a big word that was. I doubt a lot of guys could even pronounce it. But when they put that anonymous on it, they had trouble. What about the alkie? You know, an alcoholic is different than people. He's different than people. Everyone can't be an alcoholic. That is a privilege reserved for a chosen few. I don't think there's over 8 or 9% of the population anywhere that can really become alcoholic because they just don't have what it takes. An alcoholic can be, you can put him in a, you can catalog him by characteristics. And I'll give you a few of the characteristics of an alcoholic. You know, we can waste an awful lot of time fooling around with a bunch of bloody drunks that are not alcoholics. There's a lot of drunks that don't have sense enough to be an alcoholic. Really. They're stupid. I drank with some of them. I drank with those kind of people. I drank, there was the odd alcoholic in the tribes that I hung around with, but most of those guys were not, and they could drink an awful lot of booze. Get in a lot of trouble, too, but they could quit drinking like that if they make up their mind and get another hobby. But I couldn't do that. The real alcoholic, the fellow I'm looking for, is a high-strung individual. He's very impulsive. He's not a deep thinker. He'll never pose for the statue of Rodin's thinker, believe me. But he'll act. He'll do something. That's for sure. He's emotional. He doesn't ever do anything until he feels a certain way. He reacts only to feeling. When he hurts badly enough, he comes here. But what a larping he has to take first. He's lonely, and he's sensitive. Very sensitive. He's always going around looking for somebody to hurt his feelings. city, huh?
They all have what we some refer to as an inferiority complex. He's the biggest liar that ever wore shoes. This guy lies when the truth would serve him better. He lies for practice. Greatest guy in the world for self-justification. He can justify anything. It was never my fault that I got in all these jams. It was some bunch of things that happened that conspired, and I happened to land in the middle of it, really. And I could prove it. He's full of imagination. Boy, he gets an idea in it. I wish you would have been living at the time that AA book was written with those idea minute guys and those dreamers and that imagination that run wild. Bill Wilson was going to put hospitals all over the country, and Hank Parkhurst was going to, I don't know what all he was going to do, and I was supposed to go out and form all the groups and put all the people in hospitals. Don't say I had this all figured out. I went to that Rockefeller dinner with Bill and Doc Smith, with all those millionaires. Those ignuts is up there in New York trying to put the arm on those guys. It was ridiculous. But they thought they were going to get millions out of them. I told Bill you wouldn't get a nickel, and they didn't. The alcoholic is tops in his line. I don't care if this person is a nurse, a teacher, a salesman, a bookkeeper, an engineer, or what have you. A salesman, you'll always find her in the top 10. An alcoholic, a real alcoholic, can operate on 30 or 40% of his efficiency and beat the socks off of Earth people that are operating on 80. It's true. Be glad that you're an alcoholic. You're a class all of your own, and you're a superior person, believe it. And God loves you. Well, you know, what is this program of ours? Well, how come down through these centuries there have been millions and millions and millions of alcoholics who have stumbled across the face of this earth and have existed and died in alcoholism and in misery, and many times in disgrace, and many times carried their own family and friends with them? Why, ask yourself, through all these centuries, those people had no chance, and now you do. And why do we have a chance? And what is this chance? I think, by golly, that one time God looked down on these rummies after all these years, and he said to himself, by golly, I got to do something for those birds. And he got this thing started and underway, and he used the most unusual people to perform his task and his work as his servants, you and I. I was telling someone today, I look back, so a lot of you people have read that new book out on, probably read both of those, that Not God, that came out of Hazleton and by Ernie Kurtz, and also this one at Dr. Bob and the Good Old Timers. You'll see your hero running through both of these. I worked with these people and helped them as much as I could. And that book tells a story. It tells a story of AA and how it really started. And it warmed the cockles of my heart to read some of this stuff, because it's wonderful. It's real history, and it's so true, and it's so interesting. It tells something about how people were used and who was used. People, I told somebody today that my part in the formation of Alcoholics Anonymous, if I were to pick someone to do the part that I had, that I was called upon to play, I would be the last guy I'd pick. I had no qualifications for it, whatever, none. Even today, I look back at that skinny 130-pound guy back there, broke, everything gone down the drain, unemployable, everything shot. And I look at that guy and I can't believe it yet. I can't believe it. So
I can see why a lot of people over these years, I tell them some of these things, they look at me, they don't believe me. So I can't believe it myself. But it happened. It happened. So it don't take any genius to do this program. And we have a real simple program here. And since I had to change my scheduled talk around tonight, I have been asked to talk about this program and explain it tonight, as it should be. Now remember, you're listening to a guy that was in on the helping write this program. And I've been with this program for over 42 years. I know more rummies than anybody in the world. I'll gamble on that. And I've worked with an awful lot of them, and I still do. I don't work with new people anymore because I don't get a chance. I just get the ones that everybody else has screwed up. This is true. And this is what my life consists of. People come to my home from all over our country, and they want me to straighten them out on this program. How they hear from me, that's immaterial, but they do. This is not professional work. This is still a labor of love. I do this free. But it takes me 2 days to take them through this program. 2 days. And when they get through that program, they're in a new life. And that's the answer to our whole program. Let me give you this program as it's supposed to be. We have 12 steps. These 12 steps aren't original with us. We took them from the Oxford Movement. The Oxford Movement had 6 steps, but we made 12 out of them. We figured if rummies could screw up 6, they could screw up 12 much easier. And rummies can screw up anything. They screw up a 2-car funeral. There are several phases to our program. The first phase is the first step. We have to have a place to start. The first step says that we admitted we were powerless over alcohol. Now listen to what else it says. A lot of people never hear this part of it. They only hear that first part about alcohol. And our lives had become unmanageable. There is the most important part of that step. Remember that. So, my life's unmanageable. Well, I've got to look around for a manager. Right? I can't manage it, so I need a manager. So the second step, it says, I came to believe that a power greater than myself could restore me to sanity. It's odd how some of these brethren around here, when you mention sanity, they say, oh, I'm not nuts. Kids, if you're not nuts, you don't belong here. You're in the wrong coop. We're the greatest collection of nuts in society. And be proud of it. If you don't think you're nuts, look back on some of the antics you pulled the last times you were drinking. If those are the antics of sane people, let me know about it. So I came to believe that some other power could help me. How did I come to believe this? I didn't believe this when I got here. But those men, by the power of their example, they told me this power had helped them, and it would help me if I would ask him to. Simple as that. So the third step is where I hire the new manager. Third step says, I made a decision. That's something in itself for me to do. I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of my new manager, whom I call God. And I might mention in the same breath that there's, to me, there's only one God. If somebody has a few more of them, I don't go along with that deal. I only have one. You see, people are coming to me, they ask me, they want what I have. It says, that Richard read a little while ago, it says, if you want what we have and are willing to go to any lengths to get it, you are now ready to take certain steps. Well, this is what I have, and if they don't like it, goodbye. It's just that simple. I'm not going to change my program for them. They've been having a great program all this time, that's why they're looking for me. I sure don't want to change for theirs. So they'll do what I tell them, and I'll give them what I have, and this is what I have. And I only have one God, and he's alive. They say, how about these guys that are Buddhists? How about the Zens? How about all? Those guys are dead. I don't have a dead God. Those guys are dead a long time ago. I want somebody I can talk to. I have to. My program demands it. The steps demand it. All right, so most people that I find in AA that come to my home get hung up either on the third or the fourth step. These are their bugaboos. They start making holding reservations. Fourth step says we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. I ask them about resentments, ask them about fear, self-pity, self-justification, self-importance, self-condemnation, dishonesty, impatience, hate, false pride, jealousy, and on and on, those kind of things I ask them about. That's what I'm interested in. Are they harboring that stuff in them? Okay? This is what we have to get rid of. I'm not interested in these women come, same as men, they want to tell me all about their bed crawling and all that crap. I don't want to hear this stuff. I'm not interested in those things. I'm not interested in these guys who are not holding up grocery stores or they're stealing out of their wives' purses. This is all, I don't want to hear that crap. I want to know what their characteristics are that they have to get rid of. So I have 20 questions. I ask them and they tell me yes or no. Usually the people answer yes to about 8 to 10 of these 20. They've had that many negative qualities. Well, okay, we will get down and have to take care of that. That's what it asks for in the fourth step, not the details. I don't know how people can write all this garbage because I used to be a guy that had blackouts and I don't remember all the most interesting things I did. I couldn't do this. So, forget it. I want that. But I want to know the characteristics
that are harming you. Then we can get them removed. And they'll go like that, too. Don't you think they won't? All right.
If you hire that manager in step three, they will.
If you don't hire him, if you're kidding anybody, you're only cheating yourself unless you hire that manager. So it says here, after looking at those things, it says, I admit it to God, that's my new manager, to ourselves and to another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs, not the wrongs, the nature of them. You get that? That's step four, that people struggle over month after month and year after year when they should go through them right off the bat and have it over with. The nature of the wrongs. We're entirely ready, it says. Didn't say we're... Then it says we're entirely ready. What? Can we remove them? No. Entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Did you get that? All of them. It doesn't give us any leeway to hang on to any of them. We can't. There are several defects of character I would prefer to keep, the fun things. Right? Everyone recognizes that. But our program does not give us that option. An alcoholic is an extremist. He never does anything by halfway measures. When he works hard, he plays. He plays hard. When he gets drunk, he makes a career out of it. If we're going to straighten our life around, it has to be the whole way, too. You see, the illogic of a rummy, he will live a life of extreme, and then he will kid himself and lie to himself into a belief that he can clean up his life in little particles and keep the messy stuff that he likes. When we're taking an inventory, I was talking a little about this a while ago. See, supposing you're tired of working and decide you want to go into business. A fellow down the street has a grocery store. He's had it there for 30 years. So you buy his grocery. He wants to retire. And you, what are the first thing you do when you go in there? You take an inventory. You see what you have on the stock to handle to your customers. That guy's been in there for 30 years, and you look around the shelves and you find a bunch of boxes up there that have been there for 30 years. They're full of fly specks, and the boxes are broken open. They're crap. You're not going to hand that to your customers. You're going out in a new business. You're going to get rid of that junk. You'll throw it out and replace it with some good stock that you can make some money on and make friends with, right? But people come around here and they want to hang on to some of these little things that they have no business hanging on to. This is where they fail. They won't fail if they do this properly. So, it says we are entirely ready to have God remove them. I can't remove them, so I have to have him remove them. All these defects of character. Then what does it say? It says in step seven, we humbly asked him. We humbly asked him. The good book tells me this. Anything I ask, believing, I shall receive. Ask not and you get not. Ask and you receive. It's just that simple. It's that simple. You have to believe this. If you don't believe this, you're going to cheat yourself. Just forget all your smart-aleck ideas about how smart you are and how bright you are. You admitted right off the start that you are helpless and you can't help yourself. So let's get right down to business. You got to help her. The first phase was admission as a first step. The second phase was submission. That has been the second through seven steps where we submitted our will and our life unreservedly to our new manager, whom I call God. God. Right? Now we go into the third phase of our program. If we're going into the new life that we're headed for, we have to clean up some garbage from the old. So the third phase is restitution. People come to my house, the first day I take them through seven steps. Then I give them a sheet of paper and send them about to wherever they're going. If they're not staying at my house or staying at a motel or something, they'll send them and tell them to fill out that paper, write down who they owe apologies to, and I tell them who they should put down there. Their mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, cousins, uncles, aunts, grandma, grandpa, and so forth and so on, their friends, neighbors, people they worked for, people they worked, and anybody they owe money to, any loan companies they've clipped, and so forth. And I say, bring that back to me the next day, and we'll see what we do about it. So they bring it back to me the next day, and I tell them what to do with every one of those restitution situations. Some of those people you can't make restitution to. They're gone. They're dead or they moved out of your orbit. There's no way you can get with them. You don't even know where they are. Well, you leave. That's your manager. That's a great thing to have a manager. You know, we're great guys for letting George do it. Let G do it now. Let him do it. But the ones that we know about, we're obliged to face the music and get it over with. It's the only way we're going to get our life cleaned up. Because things might come up someday to upset our new life. I can stand here and tell you some examples that it's hard for you to believe in restitution that people have done. Unbelievable. I'll tell you one. I don't care if I run over. I met a fellow some years ago, a young man over in Tampa, Florida. I was living in St. Petersburg then, and I used to go in Tampa a lot. I sat around that club chewing the fat. This fellow's a nice fellow, personable guy, and he married a little girl over there, and he was getting along all right. All of a sudden, his little wife left him and went back to West Virginia, wherever she came from, and he disappeared. And I didn't see anything of him for several years. I was walking down the street in Sarasota, Florida one day, and he walks right smack into me. I look at this guy, and he looked like death warmed over. I mean it. He was run down at the heels. He was emaciated. He was sick. He was scared silly. The man had fear all over him. And he's looking over his shoulder and all this stuff. And he says, Clarence, of all the people in the world, you're the one person I want to see. I want to talk to you. I said, all right, let's go talk. So we sat down in the lobby of a hotel and he told me a sad story. And I'll tell you, he had some restitution to take care of, believe me. This fellow had left Tampa, and I don't know, some of you people might know that in southeast Florida and down that way, a lot of that property was developed, it was owned and operated by the mafia, but not under their name, thank you. They had funds to do this. And he got a job working for those people as their payroll man and bookkeeper and all this sort of thing, office man. And one day he took off for the bank and get the payroll, but he never came back to the office with it. And the mafia takes a dim view of these kind of acrobatics. So they are looking for him, and they want to present him with a concrete overcoat, which they will put him in the bottom of the Gulf with, you know, whenever they find him. He had been married five times. He had kids with four of his wives. No wife ever died, and he didn't have any divorces. You know? Sounds like this guy's getting in trouble. he had knocked over two drugstores. And of course, he's looking around to get tagged for that. Of course, we won't even mention the income tax people, haven't caught up with him for several years. And a few more little goodies like this, and this guy's in a mill of a hess. And do you know that guy never got his concrete overcoat? He never has spent a day in jail. And he is a respected citizen today. But don't you think there wasn't a lot of things pulled off to get this accomplished? But only alcoholics can do this kind of maneuvering. But he had to stay out of it. But it worked. That's an extreme case. But the man would have never lived. Everything was done. Everything was gone. I can tell you a lot of them, but I can take the time. But I want you to know about that one, because it's important. That's what restitution. After restitution, we go and make this. It says we made direct amends wherever possible, except when it is so to injure them or others. No one should ever take that eighth and ninth step without the help of a knowledgeable sponsor to help him. You can't do that by yourself. You should have some helping you. All right, we've had nine steps. We've done them. We've done them. Remember, we've done them. Not read them. Not listen to them, not saw them on the wall at the club. We've done them. We went through it. Everyone demanded action of us. Everything, every step made us do something. We had to get up and move. Action, action, action. We've taken the nine steps, now forget them. Forget them. You don't have to mess with them anymore. How about that? Ain't that something? So we're talking about a 12-step program. We got it down to a 3-step program now. All you and I have to be concerned about after we do our nine steps is 3 steps. And this is a phase of construction. Here's where we construct our life. The 10th step is an inventory step. It has nothing to do with the 4th step, which is an inventory step also. The 4th step says we made a searching for this moral inventory. Don't say that in the 10th step. It says we continue to take a personal inventory. And one other thing it says, and when we were wrong, we promptly admitted it. A personal inventory is a check on our day's activities every day. You hear all these verbs around AA like a day at a time. What does that mean? You ask 9 out of 10 rummies sitting in a club what that means. They say, I want to stay sober a day at a time. That ain't what it means at all. It means I'm living a day at a time. This is a living program. You didn't see anything about sobriety in this program yet. Alcohol is only mentioned in the whole 12 steps. There's 200 words in that step where alcohol is mentioned once. Did you ever notice that? But all those other steps have something to do with straightening our life up. This is a life-changing program. So the 10th step is important because it is a check on my life every day. How do I do this? I have a very simple program. I'm not smart enough to have a complicated program. If I went into psychiatry and all that stuff, I'd go crazier than I am, because I can't handle those mental acrobatics. I have to have something simple and easy. So here I'm going to keep my life simple. How do I do my 10th step? Every night, when I get to bed, that my day is over with, this is my prayer time. I'm alone as far as I'm concerned. I'm there and my lights are out, and I have my time to think about my day today. And I think about what I've done today, who I've met, who I've talked to, what's occurred today. Did I do any good today? If so, I give myself a pat on the back. You get a star for that one, old boy. On the other hand, maybe I hurt you. Maybe I did something and I owe you an apology. Bingo, I can't wait. I got to get that taken care of right away. I cannot let those things. Procrastination is one of our biggest sins. It's one of those 20 questions, procrastination. I have to take care of that. I'll tell you why. It's the little things that make us or break us. It's not the big things. There isn't enough big things that ever happen to us in a lifetime. You can count the big things that happen in your life on your fingers and have a few fingers left over. Figure it out. What big things ever happen to you? You're born. That's a big one. It's important. Maybe you had the benefit of a good education. That's wonderful. I'd consider that a big thing. Maybe you become successful in business. I'd consider that very important. Every time you get married, it's a big thing. Right? Sure. The love of a lifetime. Nothing like it. Every time. Well, you have a family. I consider that very important. Well, what next? You die. That's the last one. What happens? Take you out and plant you. A few people cry about it. Wind comes along, blows the grass over your grave. Somebody else is doing your work. There's a lot of other people out there laying there. They're very important one time, but they're gone. That's how many big things. One other big thing might happen. Maybe you inherit $1 million. How many people did that here? Well, Woods is full of them. So big things don't happen, kids. It's the little things every day that make or break us and make us happy or miserable and so forth. This is what makes for a great life, is the little things, not the big things. Okay. Eleventh step, listen to this one, a lot of words in this. It's a hummer. It says we're seeking something. I sought through prayer and meditation to improve my conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of His will for me and the power to carry that out. Let's break that down. It says I'm seeking something through prayer and meditation. What is prayer and what is meditation, pray tell? To me, prayer is talking to my new manager. Meditation is listening to him. Isn't it odd that the good Lord gave me 2 ears and 1 mouth? You think that ought to suggest something?
we're not going to have anything to express unless we listen for the direction. So I'm seeking through listening to him and talking to him to improve my conscious contact with him. What does that mean? Well, that means that I will have to feel that he's just as close to me as you sitting down here. I can talk to him, I can feel him, I can get answers. He's not way out in the blue yonder beyond those clouds where he's inaccessible. He's right here. The big job for me is to get him in here. A lot of people come to AA, you hear this old blur, they say, change your thinking. Thinking has nothing to do with it. You don't change your thinking, you change 14 inches below there. Down here is what changes, not up here. You can be the craziest loon in the world and still get drunk. You might even stay sober. But here is where you get the happiness and the satisfaction. The way to live is in here. That's the change. So I thought through talking to him and listening to him to improve my conscious contact with him. Then it tells me what I'm praying for. Ask most people in AA what they pray for. Every morning they say, I pray to stay sober today. Isn't that ridiculous? Don't ever do that. If you have taken these steps, don't you ever pray to be sober. You've got sobriety. Thank him for it. You've got a lot of other things you need. It tells you what to pray for. It says praying only. It says only for knowledge of his will for me and the power to carry that out. What do you want me to do, boss? I'm your boy. Send me and give me the power to do it. But good book tells me that he'll never put anything on me that he won't give me the power to execute. And I believe that. And you better believe it too. It's true. I've had a long time to find this out and to learn, to practice, and see it happen with a lot of other people. Twelfth step. Listen to this one. You hear about these 12 steppers. What does it mean, 12 stepping? 12 steps is having had a spiritual experience as the result of these steps. We tried to carry this message to other alcoholics and to practice these principles in all of our affairs. Having had a spiritual experience, what is that? That's not that change here, kids. It's that change in here. You're a different person. Changed person, a different guy. I'll tell you something that happened to me one time. It was one of the greatest things that ever happened in my experience in this fellowship. I mentioned a while ago that most of my real lessons came after meetings. I sat around a lot of those meetings and I didn't know what was going on, really. There were more civilians and others than drunks. And I watched all this going on all the time, and some of it was like, took in some of it I couldn't understand. But a fellow came to me one night. Clancy has mentioned this fellow today. Old Bill Van Horn was a rummy that lived down in Kent, Ohio, which was a suburb of Akron. And Bill had a little pension he got from, I don't know, someplace. Every month he got this small pension. And every time he got this pension, he'd go hog wild. And he had a bad hobby. He liked to fight policemen. And this is a losing game, kids. You just can't win. There's too many of them. And he'd get in trouble with the policemen in Kent and in Akron, and they hammered him with those sticks so many times that his folks finally, for his own protection and the protection of the whole community, they had him probated and they put him in a nut house, the Maslin State Insane Asylum in Maslin, Ohio. My sponsor, Dr. Bob, got him out of that funny farm and got him sobered up and straightened around, and Bill never had a drink again till his dying day. Bill was a big man. He was a moose, really. He used to tower over me. For some reason or other,
I only weighed 130 pounds when I came here, so I wasn't much then. I've got more beef on me now, anyway. But he used to tower over me and get me in a corner. Every night after a meeting in T. Henry's home, he'd get me behind that library table where I couldn't get away. And he'd talk to me. And he would tell me what I should be doing. One night, Bill came to me. He had me back at that table again. He says, Clarence, I'm going to give you the answer to this whole ball of wax. I'm going to give you something here. I want you to read it. I want you to memorize it. I don't want you to ever forget it. These are how we got suggestions. Bill takes out his billfold and starts unloading all this debris out of it on T. Henry's table. And finally, he comes to what he's looking for. He has a sheet of paper, a little piece of paper, and he hands it to me, this paper to me. And I looked at this paper. I read it, and here it's a Bible verse. And I look at this Bible verse. I look at this big gorilla in front of me. I thought maybe they did let this guy out too soon, you know? But here's what it was. And I did what Bill told me to do. And it's my very favorite verse in Scripture. It's the 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, 17th verse. And reads this way. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. How about that? Does that sound the answer to this? Is that our program? Old things are passed away. All things are become new. If any man be in Christ. My golly, that finally sunk through to me, and I lived with that. That one thing had more to do with changing my direction than anything that had happened to me up to that time. I hope it benefits someone here. So that 12th step, as the result of these steps, not because we go to meetings, not because we go to clubs, not because we do 12-step work, it says as a result of these steps, we had this change. We take these steps and something happens to us. I was telling a little girl tonight, of all the people, men and women, who've come to my house and have gone through this program, and I mean some of these people are really screwed up. I mean, I don't ever get them until everybody's messed them up. I have never heard of one who ever drank again. And they're all having good lives. Good lives. This is something. But they took this program after having abused themselves or abused it or abused other people with it all this time, and people have abused them with it. Now they've got it, and it changed their life around. This is a life-changing program. And what a life it is. Next month I'll be 78 years old. Down through these 42, 43 years coming up that I have had in this, the benefit and the privilege of in this fellowship, lots of things have happened to me. This hasn't been all beer and Skittles. I'm a sort of an oddball in AA. You'll read in Ernie's book, he says Clarence has an abrasive personality.
And he is correct. I laugh. There's a guy in New York office is writing a new book now on Bill. He called me up a few weeks ago, spent a few hours on the phone. He tapes all this stuff. And he says, hey, what do you think, what was your opinion of this thing that Ernie Trich said about your abrasive personality? I said, Buster, he's correct. People either love me or hate me. I stand for something, and I'm too bad to change. But I know what the results are. I've seen it in so many people. If they'll take this program, this simple program of 200 well-chosen words, and put it into their life, your life is going to change. You have to believe this. See, people say, oh, I don't have the faith. Don't forget it. We all have faith. We all have given a measure of faith. What do we do that's important? People say, here are a bunch of people sitting here that came from everywhere. Half of you come into this convention here in an airplane. Did you know that pilot driving that plane? You were well acquainted with him, huh? You knew the guys up in the tower and everything. You knew all this stuff. Horse feathers. You had to have faith that man's going to bring you here. You never gave a thought that he might not. You have faith in these things. You have faith in a lot of things. When you put your faith where it belongs, then everything good's going to happen. I promise you. I've had a good life. I have some terrific friends around this world. I know people everywhere. I have people around this world that throw rocks at me, too. And that's all right. Their aim isn't too good. It's a funny thing. I learned about AA and about unity in AA. There is no such thing. AA survives on riots. I learned this lesson very early in my career. As you probably heard tonight, I started the Cleveland Group. That was the first group of Alcoholics Anonymous in the world. I broke them out of the Oxford Group and started the AA group there, just for alcoholics and their families. And boy, all those people that started, I brought in there and sweated and worked. I told some people today how long it took me before I got my first baby sold on this AA thing. I'm telling you, it was murder. I finally got my first one, and all of those dozen men going down there, I brought into the fellowship. Along came the time when I got all that plain dealer publicity, when people started, the inquiries come in by the hundreds. And some of these people took a dim view of this. They got worried about their amimimimi. And they jumped on me. And they says, the guy's making money. He's going to get paid for this. He's doing this. And he's going to put our pictures in the paper and all that crap. So they decided, they voted me out of AA. My friends. I was voted out. But by this time, we had 30 or 40 other people in there, and they didn't agree, so we had our first unity. And we didn't split in two groups, we split in three. Nothing like doing it up brown. Well, that's the way it works. Nobody starts a group because they need a group. You get mad at somebody. And you choose up sides, and if we stay together, we'll kill each other. But I got the shock of my life when they did this to me. Poor little old me, after all I did for those bums. But I learned why this is necessary. I learned over the years, I've seen it year after year. And I've seen this fellowship grow year after year and year after year. I can remember looking at our first group in Cleveland, Ohio, and I said to myself, I remember like it was yesterday. I said, boy, if we ever had as many as 35 members here, wouldn't this be a wonderful thing? It wasn't 2 years' time we had 35 groups in that city. I don't know how many hundred they have now, but they have them everywhere. It's gone all over the world. Who would have dreamt that from that beginning, AA would come into a thing like this, all over the world? And you and I can meet with these people any place we go, and we're met on a different basis than any society you've ever been in. All you have to do is walk into an AA activity wherever you may be, from Africa to Venezuela, and you, it's the same thing. You meet people who have the same thing in common, and they have the same hopes, same desires, and same love. Great. Where will you find this other than here? You and I are the most fortunate people in the world. We are God's chosen people. They used to talk about the Jews being a God's chosen. It's all right if it's Jews in AA, he's twice chosen. I don't know what time it is. Am I over time? He tells me I'm over time. I'm glad. We're going to have a dance. So get out there and shake a leg. Watch that dance from last night. Don't try that stuff tonight. There's not enough chiropractors in Hawaii to help you. It's been a great pleasure being with you, visiting with you, loving with you. I'm going to be around a few days. I'll probably be around a few meetings, I hope. Somebody's going to haul me around here and there. Wherever they take me, I don't know, but I'll be there. And I'm going to enjoy myself while I'm here. I've enjoyed this tremendously. This has been a great thrill to me to be here. And I've been to some distant places, like Alaska and places like that. But this place always had a hell of a charm for me. And I always wanted to get here, and here I am. I had to wait all these years to do it. I don't think I could have stood it when I was young. But you have a great place here, and I said to someone today, I live in Florida, and we're second best. Florida's second, Arizona's the best place in the world. And I'm going to go a little disloyal, and I'm going to be honest about it. You got it beat here. Thank you very much.